Hey YouTube, Joyboy here. So, One Piece chapter 990 is out. If you haven't checked out that chapter yet, I suggest that you do so because I will be spoiling you. But now that you have, let's begin. There were a lot of details in this chapter and a lot of things that I feel like will have greater payoff later. But let's start at the beginning. Finally, we are going to see a legitimate reunion between Pound and his daughters. But like, not gonna lie, I really enjoyed this cover page because the reason why they finally believed that he was their father is it was just so wholesome. Just like Mama told us, our father is a stubborn man who gets up no matter how many times he gets knocked down. Come on, man. I need to see that happily ever after. Grandpa Pound needs to make up for that lost time. I would just say that I'm kind of surprised that Big Mom wasn't more harsh about him to her daughters. You know, given Pound was supposedly kicked out of Totland and should have been executed, you would think that Big Mom would have been a little bit more depreciative of him. Your father is a coward, your father is a loser, your father is an idiot, your father is a traitor, that sort of thing. And I mean, come on, let's be honest, some of these things are definitely true and others are circumstantially true. Instead, Big Mom told Lola and Chiffon what their father was actually like. She complimented him. Your father is or was resilient. I wasn't expecting that. But anyway, to the chapter itself, Big Mom unintentionally freed Sasaki. Her attack went a very great distance and was still strong enough to cut the giant tree Sasaki was tied to in half. Big Mom is the weakest Yonko camp. It's really silent this week. And I think that includes me as well to some degree. Honestly, guys, we could talk about this particular scene for a long while. I think that there's so much here that is genius and not obviously apparent. But instead, what I'll do is make an entire video about it later. But just to say something here, I think Oda accomplished several things simultaneously. First, he used this as an opportunity to further explain Big Mom's strength. He very clearly illustrated and highlighted that this was a feat for Big Mom. Having an attack that was as destructive as it was this far away is not normal. Just for like a point of reference here so that you can really understand the scope of this attack, I really think that you should be considering this of a similar power level to Kaido's blast breath. I don't think that that's hyperbole. I think that if Big Mom did the same sort of attack, she could blow off the top of a mountain as well. Now, is it as strong as the blast breath? I would think not. But still, of comparable, you should compare them, they are similar. She is absurdly powerful. At the same time, Oda used this as an unexpected and creative way of freeing Sasaki. Sasaki could have freed himself. Some member of the Beast Pirates could have stumbled upon him, found him, and then freed him. But nope, Big Mom instead totally destroyed the tree he was tied to. And the third thing that Oda accomplished is that this tree also has some religious or spiritual significance. And I believe that it will lead into even crazier things happening in the story later. Three birds, one spear of Elbaf. But just as a side note here, I'm finding that I'm liking Sasaki a lot more, especially after this chapter. He seems like a prime candidate to turn coat, to switch sides. And you know, my impression is that he's really chill and seems like a cool dude. You know, he called Kyoshiro his best friend, and yeah, maybe he's a little hurt about being tied up and whatnot. But you know, Kyoshiro didn't actually do any lasting damage to him, so maybe he will appreciate that. Plus, as we know about all of the Flying Six, they were former captains, and so their loyalty is tenuous at best. But from here, we move on to the roof where the Minks were fighting Kaido and Jack. I think that this is going to look absolutely stunning in the anime, if they spend any time on it whatsoever. The Minks flashing around, I think, would add so much that just the still image, you know, can't easily portray. In this way, I think that especially these scenes with the Minks in this chapter, the anime will make this a million times better than what I actually got from it in this chapter. A lot of it was very hard to make out, at least for me, but I don't have eagle eyes. But I guess to the fight itself, overall, it doesn't seem to be going very well. Kaido doesn't look bothered or damaged at all. Meanwhile, the Scabbards and Kinemon look very beat up. Jack has a few injuries. I even see like a sword sticking out of him, so that can't be comfortable. But you know, he's taking on an absurd number of Minks and doesn't seem particularly close to being defeated yet. I'm actually pretty surprised that Oda isn't really showing this fight at all up until this point, and I think that that speaks to just how poorly they are doing and how ineffective their attacks have been, at least up until now. But at the end of the chapter, it seems as though Nakamimushi and Inarashi are going to take their turn of going Sulong. So my guess is that they are going to fight Jack, who has not been defeated by the Musketeers like the Musketeers said that they were going to do. But yeah, even if they manage to defeat Jack, and yes, I do think that they might defeat Jack, none of this feels good to me. And even if they were to defeat Jack, I expect him to get back up later. Compounding this feeling of like, this doesn't seem very good, it doesn't help that Queen has been slowly trying to figure out that Otama exists this entire time. I'm not entirely sure if I know what Oda is trying to accomplish, but it cannot be good. Anyway, in case you missed this, Queen was talking about the prisoners being free, Luffy leading them. He's thinking about like, okay, how did we get here? And is totally confused why Babanuki from the prison didn't report it to him. Like, Queen seems like a pretty smart guy, he knows his pawns, he seems to understand that Babanuki would not have reported this if it wasn't true, but, you know, it must have been, there's all sorts of things that doesn't make sense to him. But he can put the pieces together. The things he's missing here is Otama's devil fruit. If you guys remember, Otama tamed Babanuki using her devil fruit. And I'm sure there's already been reports of Speed's betrayal, as well as Holdem seems to have an even greater idea of what Otama is capable of. I think either of these situations could lead to Queen figuring out if he could not do it already. This is the second time Oda has shown him thinking on this mystery, the first time being in chapter 980. I think that you have to wonder whether Queen is going to figure out Otama and her devil fruit, and then actually counter it in time. So we're all thinking like, oh yeah, it seems very straightforward. Otama's gonna defeat all the smile users, and then Queen is gonna come in there like, wait, not so fast. I done figured you out. I understand that it's crazy thinking three steps ahead. We don't even know where Otama is right now, or if she's even here. I mean, she will get here at some point, but like, we don't know any of this. But I do expect Queen to do something. This seems to be, as far as I'm aware, the only thing that Oda could be setting up here. Anyway, I was a bit confused the first time that I read the chapter. For some reason, I thought King was asking the Tobi Roppo to betray him right now. But on second read, it's very obviously X-Drake saying this to Basil Hawkins. Drake trying to be sneaky and get Basil Hawkins against Kaido too. So, may never be a better time to betray your boss. Hawkins is like, kind of a questionable suggestion, man. Drake abashedly under his breath, well, it was worth a try. But literally moments later, approaching up essentially the same way, he's like, whoa, we shouldn't be fighting each other right now. I wish you guys could see my face because it is very disappointed. A lot of people are speculating on whose future Hawkins was reading. He said, that man has a 1% chance to live by the end of tonight. I assume Hawkins was talking about Luffy. If you remember from earlier in the arc, Hawkins was astounded by the fact that no matter how he interpreted the cards, Luffy never had a 0% chance of success. So 1% here seems like a Luffy fortune to me. He's always got a chance. At the same time, I think that this sets up Hawkins betraying Kaido, something that I don't think would surprise too many people out there. I think that this is fairly apparent because literally after any chapter that Basil Hawkins appears, the discussion is when is he going to join the Alliance? It's never a question of if he will, it's when. Every time. I could see Hawkins being interested in, maybe even obsessed, over Luffy just for being a fortune oddity. At some point, maybe it's obvious, but at some point I think Luffy is going to make Hawkins a believer. That 1% chance is going to look like a 99% chance maybe at some point in time. So yeah, that's my official prediction. 1% man is Luffy. After this, we had a moment where King essentially said, the competition to take on a headliner is postponed until they deal with the Straw Hat and their allies. What this means to me is that we are definitely going to see a Tobi Roppo attack Queen. I'm just saying, you bothered setting it up, but now you're calling it off. Like, I don't, you know, Oda doesn't play these games. It will happen. Otherwise, you've totally wasted our time. Oda writes tighter than that. He doesn't introduce something in order for it just to be like, oh, look, it's just really exciting, and then toss it aside like, ha, joke's on you, red herring, like, it won't work that way. So yeah, if anything, this confirms to me even more that a Tobi Roppo, I assume other than Drake would make Drake is way too obvious. A Tobi Roppo other than Drake is going to attempt to attack Queen. As I said earlier, I like Sasaki. Hell, I like Ulti and Page One as well. I don't really care who it is, I just kind of expect this. But yeah, this seems like a good time to skip ahead and talk about X-Drake. So we called the hell out of this one. Who's Who was a red herring and Queen was always after Drake, and that always made stupid amounts of sense. I always tell you, man, be careful of what Oda is trying to sell you. Oda was trying to sell Who's Who versus Queen. That's not what happened. What instead happened was a thing that made a lot of sense that he was not trying to openly sell, Queen and Drake. It's because I think about crap like this that I come off as crazy to a lot of people. But it's like, literally what the story is trying to tell you is, in many cases, not what you should be believing if you actually, you know, want to speculate. But I gotta tell you, it's really awkward to be in that place where it's like, well, the story is trying to tell us this. And then I'm like, yeah, and that's why I don't believe it. It's like, don't. Now, how exactly Drake actually got to Queen in this chapter, I'm really not too sure at all. I mean, last we saw of him, Who's Who asked him to join in, and Drake was like, no, I'm good. Then you go like 4 pages into the future, and Drake is there with Who's Who after getting squashed by Queen. What happened in the middle here, we have no idea. Kind of feel like there was maybe a story here. Maybe Hawkins chimed in and lied and said they had 100% chance of victory or something. My other thought is that Who's Who was actually intending on fighting Queen if X-Drake joined him, and then was just disappointed that X-Drake wouldn't do it. And so then they both report back to Queen, and at this point Who's Who's like, you know, you had your chance and you blew it. I kind of would want that. Either way, Drake played his hand somewhat poorly here with Law, and that led to Hawkins figuring out Drake was an enemy. This whole thing between Drake and Hawkins and Law was off screen, so we cannot be sure of all the details. But my impression is that Hawkins and Drake had captured Law in exchange for Law's crew. Law freed his crew and then turned himself in. Sometime after this, we see Law had defeated Hawkins, and Drake was there in the shadows, presumably out of view from Hawkins. From context clues, I guess, Drake was trying to keep his involvement quiet. I didn't really get that impression at the time. I assumed that Hawkins knew that Drake had helped Law, but that wasn't the case. But regardless, he messed up, and he messed with the wrong dude, because Hawkins' logic game is way too strong, and he figured out, like, you know, who could have helped Law in this case? You know, we didn't actually see what happened, but obviously Law got some sort of assistance, and it had to be Drake. That's a big oof. Not gonna lie, I kind of wanted there to be a deeper plan between Drake and Law, but again, based on this chapter, it really seems now that all Drake wanted to do was free Law so that he could create some chaos. Kind of the same as how Drake sort of nudged Hawkins in the middle of this chapter, like, oh, there's, you know, no better time to go against Kaido than now. You know, he forced you into servitude, but this is your time to shine. I kind of get the same impression with Law, like, Law seems like a good person to go up against Kaido. Well, I'm just going to let this happen. Or I'm going to sort of nudge my way in here so that it happens. You know, in retrospect, this was pretty risky for a guy who had spent, we presume, several years to set up his position in Kaido's crew. You kind of wonder whether the Big Mom and Kaido alliance has Drake also a bit of in a hurry or impatient to do something against them to prevent this. But now that he's outed, all he's got left is Luffy. I was actually really hyped up by the end of this chapter. Drake remembering what Kobe said about Luffy. I want Drake to see that Luffy is the good guy. I want that validation. Like, let's be real here. Drake, along with several other Marines, is on a very slippery slope. He saw CP0 make a shady deal with Orochi, and is going to watch a pirate Luffy fight for the people of Wano, which nobody else seems willing to do. That kind of shit makes you think about where you stand. Anyway, I'm totally expecting a Who's Who Drake fight now. That seems like it makes a ton of sense. Who's Who seems to have, you know, like a vendetta against Drake for some reason that doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me right now. And actually, fun fact, I randomly predicted this matchup, you know, from a video months ago. I'm low-key pumped up about that, because we were grasping at straws then, and now it seems like a legitimate idea. Also, I see people speculating that Hawkins already intends to betray Kaido and has some sort of plan. I don't get that impression, not yet. I think that he really just sold Drake out, and it is as it appears to be. Drake thought he was good. Hawkins sort of logically put the pieces together. You must have done this, and then Hawkins literally just sold him out. And is at this time, at this exact moment, still on the Beast Pirate side. But yeah, we were all expecting Chopper and Usopp versus the Numbers, and technically we could still see that, but it seems like the whole point of the numbers right now is for the crew to flex. Oda went out of his way to point out that the numbers are of similar strength to oars when they fought him from Thriller Bark, the oars that literally nobody in the crew could defeat except for Nightmare Luffy. Now, totally not a problem. This is how far, you know, the crew has evolved since then. But as a side note to this whole conversation, you best believe there was a low-key shout-out to Buddhism through Luffy in this chapter, Mio-O. We'll talk about this more in the future. But Oda is strengthening the Buddhism and Luffy connection. We already had the Zoro and Buddhism connection, but Luffy also has his role to play as well. In this case, he is represented by a god that literally punched enlightenment into people. I will beat you up until you are Buddhist. And really, that's how Luffy operates. The only thing out of all of this that I really feel like is worthy of pointing out that isn't obvious, did you guys notice just how hurt Zoro is? Like, he has sustained a surprising amount of damage, having essentially fought nobody. As it appears to me, he is more injured than any other ally that isn't up on the roof right now. Like, he has a huge gash on the right side of his face. We theorized this a few chapters ago. The theory is that the Scabbards have a form of haki that is unique to them based on Enma, where they can do more damage enough to be able to pierce Kaido, but the cost is their own health. And then you look at Zoro, who is actually wielding Enma, and we know what Enma does. Enma steals your life force in order to cut more. And I wonder if the same thing isn't going on here. Has he really mastered this sword already? That whole part, you know, the actual mastery of the sword, totally skipped over. I mean, we got a few panels, he seems to be using it, but has he really mastered it? I don't think that he has fought anyone that should have damaged him this much. Like, I could imagine Zoro being tired, being scuffed up, but he has sustained enormous amounts of damage. I assume that the sword is doing it. This could also explain Zoro's urgency to get to Kaido. Maybe he doesn't feel like he has an unlimited amount of time to deal with the fodder, carrying a sword that may be slowly killing him. This absolutely makes for an interesting subplot, and I just want to point this out just because Zoro's damage in this chapter really stood out to me. But yeah, guys, that's pretty much what I had to say about this chapter. This was a good chapter, but, you know, it's kind of a down from previous highs, but there was a lot of things included in this chapter that is clearly intended to pay off later. This was absolutely a setup chapter in the middle of the war. But as always, guys, I'm curious as to what you guys think, whether you noticed something from the chapter that I might have missed. Just share your thoughts. Like the video if you like the video, dislike the video if you dislike the video, subscribe if you want to be notified for my future content, and as always, guys, have a wonderful day.